Welcome to the part 2 of the Still Life Lighting Formula from Cinematic Lighting course, now on YouTube. In this video we'll pick it up where we left it in the previous one, and we'll keep tweaking the key light while learning more about Cycle's area light features. We'll also talk a bit more about three-point lighting before moving on to even more exciting things. Of course, there are a few other properties of the key light that we haven't touched yet. The color temperature and propagation, to name a few. The easiest way to control the color of the light source is obviously to use the RGB color picker. A cinematography analogy would be placing a gel over the light source to make it any color you want. Or let's say using an RGB LED panels. So there was color wheel, the first option that we have. Alternatively, if you are in the mood of dealing with the color temperature directly, you can click the Use Nodes button and then this dot near the color and choose Black Body. The Black Body node converts the temperature in Kelvins to the RGB data. Basically, this slider controls a type of radiation or light color emitted by a black body or a light source when it's heated to a certain temperature. These temperatures are measured in Kelvin. The hotter the temperature, the more blue the light appears. The temperature of 5200 makes it look like a daylight. 6500 is slightly cooler than that. It's like an overcast daylight. So yeah, basically the higher the temperature, the bluer the color. It is a standard way of dialing in the color of the light source, of balancing the light bulbs in cinema production, you name it. With that being said, to keep things simple, I will remove this node for the time being and rely on our good old color wheel instead. I will dial in the neutral white color with the saturation of 0, or using the RGB model, it should be 1 in both red, green and blue. The last slider that we haven't explored yet is the beam shape spread. As its name implies, it's a tool for shaping the directionality of light, and it can be imagined as focusing the beam, basically. From the default 180 degrees all the way to 1 degree, which makes it super focused. It is also important to note that it does correlate with the perceived softness of light. The smaller spread value does make the shadows harsher. I think we are good with the default spread value of 180, so I'm gonna control Z it all the way back. And let's imagine, if we wanted to control the spread or propagation of the light beam, what else could we do? We could have used some kind of a blocker, just a regular plain object or a box. We could have simply blocked or cut the part of the light rays to better control the propagation. Actually, we will dive deeper into shaping the beam of light later on in the course, in the second chapter, where we will use different kind of blocking techniques, as well as light textures and dappled light techniques. That is a little teaser, so obviously stay tuned. Meanwhile, because we utilize a physically plausible path tracing render engine, such as Cycles, we also automatically add some fill light in addition to our key light, just like it happens in a real-world production. So as we crank up the power of our directional light component, it also affects the power of the bounce. We can tell that the drop shadow part of the minerals isn't pitch black. It's because some part of the light rays got bounced or reflected by the environment. There are two types of bounces, diffuse and glossy, and if we dial in 0 in both, we will see what we would see in Eevee, let's say. We would see the pitch black shadow. And as soon as we bring back some of the light bounces and let Cycles do its light transport work, the shadow will get filled in a little bit. And it totally depends on the power of the light source. It works in proportion to the power of the key. I suppose it should be super intuitive and feel like home if you worked with physical light sources in production. And again, with no light bounces, it will look just like Eevee. So let's switch over to Eevee for a second, just for fun. To make it look indistinguishable from Cycles, the soft shadows in Eevee should be set to on, and then within the light settings tab, the contact shadows should be ticked. Otherwise, the shadows won't be precise enough. To double down on this, cycles with zero light bounces looks very similar to Eevee, but once the global illumination kicks in, cycles path tracing gives us a nice fill in addition to the key light in the form of the indirect bounce. That being said, further down the line in the Monastery Dungeon chapter, to be exact, we'll discuss the global illumination methods for Eevee, namely its built-in irradiance map, as well as a real-time screen space global illumination, or SSGI. Consider this a quick teaser. Eevee is a great render engine after all, and it will get its time in the spotlight, no pun intended. Eevee is so cool, but still, I'm gonna switch back to cycles in a moment. Personally, I love a physically realistic way the secondary light bounces are calculated in cycles. It's not that different from manipulating real light sources, and I think it just matches our learned expectation on realistic light transport, the secondary bounces specifically. It is a cool little effect that adds believability to everything, the photons bouncing around the scene and filling in the shadows. Well, not literally, but something like that. The amount of the bounce light is again always in proportion to the amount of the directional light, and it makes the balancing of these two components really easy and intuitive. It's like a nice contrast ratio right out of the box. Okay, now I will dial back the power of our key lights to 3700 watts. Now everything about our main light feels right to me. We can start adding some detail, I think. Right now, our key light is mainly represented by a pretty large and soft source. But that doesn't mean that we cannot throw in some directionality into it by making use of a much smaller pinpoint light source for extra glints and highlights. So again, this is our nice, soft and big light source that is responsible for 90% of the image, for all the shapes and forms that we see. And I will move it to its own collection by pressing the M key. The collection will be called Light 01. Now I will right-click and duplicate this light source, hit S and make it much smaller, M to move it to its own collection called Light underscore 02. This will be the extra component of our key light. Thinking about it, it will also serve the function of the hair light simultaneously, using the three-point lighting terminology. We will talk about three-point lighting later on. Let's just mention that three-point lighting is a fairly popular method for illuminating a subject with light sources from three distinct positions. The three types of lights are key, fill, and backlight. The key light is usually the brightest light, placed slightly off to the side to provide most important part of the lighting to our subject, revealing its form and dimension. The fill light to illuminate the shadow side. And the backlight, it's also called the hair light or the rim light, is used to pop the subject out of the background for a slightly more three-dimensional look. As we've said, this scheme is fairly popular in cinema, photography and CG lighting, so we'll be referring to it from time to time throughout this course. So getting back to the second light we have just added, it's the secondary key light, but at the same time it's the backlight that adds some extra separation to the objects in our 3D scene, so it kind of fulfills both of these functions. I mean, its main purpose will be to highlight the finer details in the silhouette as well as the glossier parts of the material. To add some extra separation with the main light, it can be slightly warmer. And by all means, it shouldn't be stronger than our main. Think of it as a supplementary touch, as just a little bit of glint on top of our main softness. So something like that. It can be slightly more focused in terms of the beam shape spread. Something like 70 degrees looks good to me. What I love about the smaller and harsher light sources is that they are good at capturing detail. It's something that the bigger and softer light sources don't necessarily achieve. And now, as a quick detour, let's quickly visit the cycles render settings. untick the noise threshold and just input some value into the samples, like 128 samples in both renderer and the viewport. And also let's activate the denoiser. If there is one feature that was a total game changer in Cycles rendering, that's the denoising. A quick reminder that the options found here in the denoise settings will be dependent on the graphics card, and that while they give slightly different results, any option is better than none. So don't worry, just select whatever you like. Now that's a fantastic advice. Like, select anything you want. But really, optics is just as good as open image denoise. It is insane how smoother the rendering process gets with the use of denoising. I'm not even talking about the viewport. In my opinion, that just brings the dream of the real-time light transport and real-time path tracing much, much closer. So let's keep it activated. Denoising, I mean. It has its own minor performance price, though. Without denoising, it's generally a little bit more responsive, the viewport, I mean. With denoising, the overall effect is smoother, but the lag is still there. Alright, so here we created the compound light source. We can think about it as just one big key light, with just a little nuance, a little hint created by this smaller, sharper source embedded into it. The smaller light in this context is just complementary to the main one. I think it's the most productive way of thinking about it. Now here's how we can do quick comparisons to track our progress. What I'll do is set up two renders, with and without that second light. So let's toggle it off in the outliner temporarily. Okay, before giving it a quick render, allow me to visit the Blender settings, the preferences I mean. And in the user interface, let's make sure that within the temporary editors tab, the render in drop-down menu, the image editor is selected. It is a matter of personal preference, obviously, but personally I prefer to see the results in the Blender user interface when I hit the render button, without 3ds maxing it with a bunch of new windows. Alright, so we have rendered the 1080p image. Now we can make a quick comparison. I'm switching to the second slot in the image editor and activating the second light component and hitting F12. That's a nice way of comparing before and after. By switching back and forth between the slots, we can do it with using the number keys. 1, 2, 1, 2. See the glossy highlights popped out and being extracted by the secondary light source? Good job. Let's check a quick before and after. This is our extra light added into the mix. So it's worth recapping a few crucial points. First of all, our light hits the object from behind, so to speak. This seemingly innocent creative choice makes all the shadows fall in our direction. So effectively, we now shoot into shadows. In other words, the camera is always standing on the shadow side. This is called the reverse key lighting or the upstage lighting. The other thing definitely worth mentioning is that our light source is brought in very close to the subject, to the scene, and so we can marvel at the light fall-off effect. That is simply put aesthetically pleasing. Well, we could have placed our light to the right or to the left as long as it's on the opposite side from the camera. It would still be the reverse key lighting. And we would still have some kind of a feel coming in from the camera side. So far it is a really balanced, really three-dimensional light setup. I love it. Even though we can say that the light setup we've created already looks pretty neat, and indeed it's based on a simple and straight-to-the-point light scheme, it's far from being finished yet. There is so much more we could do, so in the next part of this mini-series we'll add a so much-needed contrast by letting in some sunlight into our scene to ultimately make it more lively and dynamic.